Man, I just got off and ran home to be here to talk to y'all on this podcast.
And we appreciate that.
We always like it when our guests get off right before coming on the show. Hello and welcome to the Ritual Misery Podcast, episode 123 for Thursday, the 13th of April, 2017. This is a show where two lifelong friends and their guests celebrate all things geek here on DiamondClub.tv, Thursday nights, 7 p.m. Pacific. Is that about right? Something like that?
Sounds right.
Yeah, sounds good. Hey, Fitz, how you doing, man?
I'm doing good, man. I'm doing good. How about y'all?
Oh, man, this is my weekly hour of zen, and I'm so excited. It's Ritual Misery time. What's up with you, Amos?
Man, my zen would be complete if only I had been able to use the soundboard and hit the button at the right time during the five previous awesome points, which I could have hit it. But, of course, the shit wasn't working. I finally got it working. So that's the intro you get. Whatever boss jock decides you get, that's what you get on this show. That's how we run it.
That's right. Hashtag beta.
Fucking.
I'm just playing.
Fucking.
Oh, the beta gremlins do not go away forever. They keep popping their heads.
Yeah, they're like Betty White. They just keep popping up in different places. Hey, speaking of Betty White, I couldn't believe last week they couldn't think of Betty White's name on Current Geek. I'm not
right.
Sure that I think that's a racial thing, isn't it? I don't know. That's something I don't need to get into tonight. But yeah, they couldn't think of Betty White's name, and I was just like, I was yelling at my radio. Have you ever yelled at your radio? I'm pretty sure you have, because I certainly have. I yell at my radio all the time.
I thought the exact same thing, especially since we bring Betty White up quite often on this show. I was like, come on, guys. You guys obviously don't watch R&B.
Yeah.
No, I yell at Let's Players on YouTube a lot, so I get it.
I got my video card back, so I'm hosting again this week. It's nice to be back in the saddle.
Yeah, for me too.
The video card that I sent away for a small upgrade fee, that if I had waited until after the upgrade offer was over, I could have upgraded to the next higher line instead of just the newer model of the same line. Fail. That was my tech fail for the month of April. Actually, the month of March, really.
Live and learn, right? Well, you're not the only one that I don't know if I'd call this a fail. So I bought some lighting to improve my lighting situation here. I think I've evened the lighting out a little bit, at least.
You're still a little blown out in the forehead, but I mean, that's just your personality. That's nothing to do with
lights. You look very white.
So it's going to be, you know, I'm white like Betty.
Yeah, of course.
Sure, that's where you're going to go with that. Okay, cool. Maybe you should just powder before the show.
Take a powder?
Well, no, not that powder. That's
gotcha. How's your week been, Fitz? What have you been up to?
It's been pretty good, man. Working. Like I put in the show notes, I was approached by a fake Illuminati agent, and I didn't have the $480 to make it, so I just won't be white people rich with the Illuminati.
Wow.
How do you know it was fake, though? What gave that away?
The fact that he said
he was Illuminati?
It says Illuminati agent on his Facebook. And so he's not doing a very good job hiding it. And he said, you've been chosen, brother, for all the good things that you've done. And obviously, they didn't follow me too hard because I was talking shit about it on Twitter as he's talking to me. So that, and he just would, I'd be like, well, what did I do? And he'd be like, nothing. You were just blessed with the light of the Illuminati. So obviously, he's just trying to get $480 out of me. I don't know. I could have really been Illuminati and fucked that up.
I just think this, like, if someone from Anonymous came up to you and said, hi, I'm from Anonymous.
Oh, I would run the other fucking way because they already hacked my system by then.
But still, I mean, if they say they're from Anonymous, they're not anonymous anymore. Well, they're self-identifying.
Yeah, that's a self-disproving statement. That's like saying everything that I say is a lie.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
It's a self-disproving statement.
Yeah.
So, yeah, all right. So, yeah, I get it. So the guy wasn't Illuminati.
No, but, you know, me, the journalist, I was trying to egg him on and see what I could get out of him so I could expose him. That article will be incoming soon.
Right on.
My Facebook tryst with the Illuminati.
Right.
Holy crap. Man. Amos, have you been doing any Illuminati activities, like surveilling anyone or doing anything like that?
No, but I've helped eliminate the possibility of someone surveilling me.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, this right here, this is my security camera set that I just got. My wife's been bugging me to have one up for a while because she wants to know exactly how many caribou and moose go through the yard. So I just got, actually I had bought a previous one.
A caribou and a moose?
Well, I've seen moose. I suspect caribou have gone through. So, this will be our way to find out.
You ever hear them in the distance at night?
No. No. So here's okay, totally random tangent. They just made it legal in Alaska. Federally, they removed a federal restriction that now makes it legal in Alaska to hunt hibernating bears. This is some of the craziest bullshit I've ever fucking heard. Now you got to go like six levels deep because it's actually a law from like the frontier days of Alaska saying that if you find a hibernating bear of certain types and certain sizes, you can go ahead and shoot them so they're not a pest and a danger to people. And then federal law came in, said you can't kill any hibernating animals or whatever else. Most states dropped the shit off their books. Alaska left it on because who cares, right? And then the federal law was just removed. So now it is legal again to hunt and kill, not just like hunt and tame, but hunt and kill hibernating bears. Like, the fuck kind of sense? I don't know, man. The naturist in me is like, this is complete bullshit. Anyway. Yeah,
I agree.
So, yeah, I hooked those up. They're actually sitting over there. I'm doing a run test, like a heat test on them right now just to see how well they perform after like several days of sitting down here in this room, because this room is like not air conditioned or heated at all. It's like, because I don't, whatever. Also this week, I finally tinkered with IFT. I had dabbled before.
What is that?
If this, then that.
Yeah, it's okay. A service. Now, I originally signed up when it was brand new, and they basically didn't have shit. That is so sweet now. It's really, really, really fucking good. And I got all kinds of shit set up. I got like 10 little cards or whatever, 10 tools set up. It's pretty sweet.
So what's an example of a routine that you've got it?
My favorite one so far is I've been getting into Instagram lately, and if you do an Instagram and it auto posts to Twitter, it just posts a link, which is complete bullshit. But if you do the IFT, it'll actually post the picture in your tweet as opposed to just a link for people to click and go to. However, now it does the link thing to Facebook, so I gotta figure that out too. But it's a tinker's tool, but I like it a lot so far.
Right on. So probably the geekiest thing that I did this week, because I didn't have a whole lot of time to geek out on anything, but I caught an episode finally of Into the Badlands. Have you guys watched this show?
Mm-mm.
I still have yet to watch it, but I've heard nothing but good things about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's an AMC show that Netflix now has the first season of it. I think they've had it for probably at least a few weeks now. And I keep hearing like DJM and a whole bunch of people just raving about this show. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to check it out. And my initial thought was that it was going to be this like Mad Max style post-apocalyptic, shoot 'em up kind of show. Well, it's like half that. It's some sort of post-apocalyptic environment, but it's definitely not a shoot up. And they make that clear to you in the opening dialogue, because you had this narrator in the beginning explaining the situation. And it's a post-apocalyptic, well-ish post-apocalyptic future where guns have been outlawed. There are no guns. So we have all these warriors running around with swords and shit like that. And yeah, I'm only one episode in, but wow, like I'm hooked on it now. So yeah, if you get a chance, if you got like 44 minutes or whatever to give it a shot, man, check it out.
Oh, I definitely will. I've been wanting to check it out since I found out it was on Netflix.
Yeah, right on. What have you been watching lately?
Oh man, well, we just finished The Walking Dead, of course. So, other than that, nothing really. I want to check out The Expanse. You've talked about it, and I've heard other people talk about it. It sounds great. But other than that, nothing really, man.
Yep. Amos has been raving about The Expanse. Of course, Tom and Brian have been raving about it. Want to get in on that. I haven't checked it out yet either. So maybe we can watch it simultaneously or something like that. Dude,
here's another thing, though.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Because The Expanse is amazing. I'm waiting for the current season to get off of A&E or Sci-Fi or whatever and hop on the old Netflix or just be in a way that I can acquire it. I am trying to build a show list, and this goes out to all of chat room. I'm building a show list for when I have my surgery next month. I'm going to have a lot of downtime, and I want to be able to hit like particular shows. So I'm looking for recommendations on what shows to watch and catch up on. Now, they do have a couple qualifications. One, it shouldn't be like more than three seasons. If it's more than three seasons, that's I don't want to cram that much into it. So if I can catch up on like one or two seasons of something, let me know. I want it to be something that I haven't actually seen so I can dive into something new, preferably with the wife because that's how I roll. Top of
Did
the list.
Did you watch Black Mirror?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I was actually on an episode of Black Mirror Reflections with Jackie Hearn that she never published. Because I think she lost the file, and then I just keep forgetting to send it to her. But anyway, we did a full review. But I want to get into something, and it can be something long form, but I want to be able to watch just one or two seasons of it and really get a gist of the show. I don't want to subscribe to like a full 8-season marathon of Dexter, but one season or two seasons, if I can, It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia. Like, I've never watched that show either, you know?
I haven't either. I really haven't either.
So I've got the perfect suggestion.
Okay.
The entire run is three seasons, mm-hmm. and it is the greatest thing that has ever been made in the realm of fiction. Avatar The Last Airbender.
Oh, and I actually have that on my Plex.
I highly endorse that, and I highly endorse The Legend of Korra, too.
Legend of Korra
is more badass almost than The Last Airbender.
In ways, right.
There's
a lot of lore building that I really loved in Legend of Korra that really provides some meat to some of the ideas that were explored in Avatar. But I think for me personally, I think Avatar The Last Airbender is the perfect epic. Like, it begins and ends exactly where it should have. And all the stuff in the middle is just juicy goodness, and I love it so much.
I love it too. I even love their filler episodes.
Something else that's on it is Clone Wars.
Yeah,
that's on my
first
short list.
Seasons was pretty good.
That's way more than two or three seasons though. Clone Wars I think had like what was it six or seven seasons?
Yeah.
Right. So however, it's something I can get into with one or two seasons and really decide if I want to continue watching it. And that's kind of
the episodes are really quick too. They're not long at all.
Yeah.
And it's definitely a show that gets better as it goes. Because you can I don't want to say it had a rocky start, but it's a different show at the beginning than what it is at the end.
So
by the end it is like epic level.
So to define this, I want it to be something I can sink my teeth into in one or two seasons. I can really understand if I'm going to like it or not. Not something that's like Breaking Bad is really good. The first season, second season kind of lulled, but by the time you get back to the fourth or fifth season, like it's just coming at you hard and heavy. Like, I don't want to wait that long for something to really grab me. I would prefer to have it something I can watch with either my kids or my wife, because they're going to be on spring break a week after my surgery, or on summer break a week after my surgery. So something I can enjoy with the wife or the kids, and something that I can really get into in just one or two seasons. That's kind of where I'm at with it, and that's what I'm looking for. So
Avatar fits the bill for all those requirements.
Yeah, I was gonna say I'm with Kent's pick then, because even my wife loved Avatar, and she didn't like when we got together. She didn't like any anime or any cartoons, and it got her into anime and all that.
Right on.
Right on.
So Fitz, you didn't find a lot of time for any TV this week, but have you been checking out any YouTube or any streaming internet?
My job is YouTube, so pretty much, of course. Right now, there's so much going on with YouTube, man. When it comes to, I just released an article about them restricting the LGBTQ community and making them restricted their content when all they're talking about is their love life and their life in general. And also, the ads and the banks advertisers and banks have pulled out of YouTube because they found content that was funding ISIS. Was going to ISIS funded little cells and everything. So yes, of course, YouTube. And then this girl going to release a sex tape when she hits a million subs. So there's also that.
Let's
so everybody go follow her and subscribe right now.
we'll be sure to put a link to that.
So
YouTube channel.
So are we taking an official stance that we are pro 1 million subscriber YouTube sex tape? Is that
I mean, it's been going on for a while, you know. everybody's like nudes at a million now, so hell, who knows.
I saw that you posted on Twitter nudes at 1,000 followers. Follow through with that, because I foresee that you will hit 1,000.
I'm at 904 now, so I only need 96 more. We'll see.
I said, everybody, real quick, follow Fitz and get all your friends to follow Fitz as well. I want to see how this plays out.
See, I should do the opposite of that. I should be like, if we don't have 100 subscribers by June 1st, I'm going to post nudes. Because everybody would just be scared shitless if you're subscribing.
It'll be the greatest boom that ever happened to R&P.
Hey, so I hear you've been playing Mass Effect, man.
Yeah, apparently everybody knows that. Yeah, Mass Effect, I've never beat the first or second game.
Or three.
So I wanted to start before I play Andromeda and go back and play all three.
Yeah, I actually have the trilogy for the 360, and I played part of one and part of three. Well, I played part of three, then found out it was a trilogy. And I know, and it sounds weird. Yeah, it was Mass Effect 3. You didn't know it was a trilogy? No, I didn't know it was an actual trilogy. I thought they were just sequential. So I went back and started playing one and made about halfway through one and just got caught up with life.
Well, you know, I did the same thing you did. It's not I didn't know it was a trilogy, but I didn't know that it used Commander Shepard throughout all three games.
Mm. Yeah, exactly.
Because by the time Mass Effect 3 happens, it's already been 1,000 years in the timeline in Mass Effect 3 from 1 to 3. So.
Hey,
I'm just a gamer nerd. That's all that is.
So do you have you have a subscriber base on your YouTube, right?
No, actually, I don't make YouTube videos. I just write YouTube news and podcasters. And, you know, my first article was Jason Murphy. Everybody's heard of this. And then I wrote an article on Justin Robert Young, then Brian Brushwood, and then you, Amos. And then Dundell Noches will be later tonight. I can't cook waffles and edit at the same time, unfortunately.
Well, we have a little thing that we do that helps out this show, helps get it off the ground, and it's a little thing you may have heard of it, and you might even look into doing something like this for yourself. It's simply amazing, and we currently have 18 people hawking up a little bit of cash each week, helping this show out on patreon.com/ritualmisery. 18 of the raddest motherfuckers on the planet. Kicking
Dude,
over.
Oh, I'm one of those 18 now.
You are, in fact. You are our newest patron.
This week, our guest was announced last week as being one of our patrons.
Yep.
And it just so happens that you are the newest patron, and you were the first one to say, yeah, I'll do it. So thank you so much, not only for your patronage, but also for being our guest. our patrons get so much cool stuff, man. We give them the full pre-show, the full post-show, any extra videos that come out, early announcements for RMP events,
such as last
all
night.
All kinds of cool stuff.
Yep. Hey, and I also want to give a quick shout out to Jackie Hearn for increasing her pledge. So thank you very much, Jackie Hearn.
Yes, that's thank you. Awesome. Thank you to all the patrons. Like, so, you guys are absolutely rad.
Hey, that's enough of that shit, though. It's about time for some of this.
You've got 60 seconds. Get your mind right. It's time for hot takes on the Ritual Misery Podcast.
All right, Fitz. I'm going to give you some topics. You are going to talk, rant, rave, whatever it is you want to do about that topic. And then you're going to hear that sound, and you're going to shut up and get your next topic, and we're going to keep rolling. It's going to last about a minute. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. Diamond Club. Am I right?
Man, Diamond Club's great. You know, it's a place I get to type LMAO all the time, and I'm just glad to be a part of it. You know, it was rough to be here at first. I got banned, but now I'm back, and everybody accepts me, so it's just great. I was waiting for that. Yeah, there we go.
PewDiePie, am I right?
Oh, man, PewDiePie's great and awesome, and I don't give a fuck. I laughed at the Fiverr joke as soon as they held up death to all Jews, and I love Jews, mind you, but I laughed my ass off. And, you know, you can get
Twitter typos, am I right?
Oh, Twitter typos. Typos is my game, man. That's what I do. So every time I typo, they're like, oh, that's just a Fitz typo. But actually, in my articles, I do.
Justin Robert Young, am I right?
Jury's awesome, man. He's great as a pile of biscuits, you know, and I just love him as the ad dragon, and I just come on and I just do what I can for Jury, and I ask him a million questions, and he just answers them for me just the way he can. All right. I got the ad dragon in.
The Ritual Misery Podcast, am I right?
RMP's great. I really do love the show. I'm glad you fuckos had me on, and it's always worth throwing them a buck, so everybody go throw them a buck.
Awesome, man. That was one of the most entertaining hot take segments that we have ever had. Thank you so much for being that fucking cool about it. Oh, my God.
I try, man.
You know what makes this show good is having crazy-ass fucked-up guests like you.
I fully admit that I'm crazy and fucked up.
Now for those that don't know, you attempted to come to South By.
Oh yes, I did.
Can you explain how fates turned against you on your trip to South By, and how you showed resiliency and made it anyway?
Well, I didn't make it anyway.
Look, man, that's not the story here. All right.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm going down I-65 South. I'm doing about 75 miles an hour, and you know, in a movie where it shows that one part fuck up and it flies out and then it slow-mos on that part and then it pans around and it shows the whole thing explode. Well, just imagine that with my tire doing 80 miles faster than I'm going and my face being like, oh, shit. But luckily, I didn't hit the brakes and I let it coast to a stop, and I squeezed in between two semis and got around one and parked on the side. God was with me, thank God. Or whoever you praise, whoever that is.
Some supernatural being was looking out for you, you think.
Exactly. If you're coming back from Texas and you're going through Hope Hill, Alabama, please look for my fucking tire. It's somewhere on between exit 153 to exit 154.
Yeah, chat realm, get on that. If you're anywhere in that area, go looking. Jesus. What if somebody finds it and they decide to keep it as a souvenir, like a chat realm?
Oh, I'll sign it for them. That's what I'll do.
That is awesome.
Jerry Fax is going to find it, put a sticker on it, leave it there. That's what he's going to do.
Yes. That's probably accurate.
Oh, man. So you talked about, you know, you do a lot of writing and stuff like that. You wrote a little piece on me. You've got to work. We got a piece in the work on Kent, which I'm sure took a lot more effort than my piece, because holy shit, I mean, you really got to dig to find out anything interesting about Kent.
Accurate.
But you've what inspired you to start writing, man? What like, why do you write?
Well, you know, my aunt's a journalist, and my uncle always was he always pushed me to be a writer. And one day I just happened to be sitting there, and I was like, hell, I'm gonna start a newsletter. And I reached out to Jason Murphy and asked him for an interview. He was kind enough to oblige. I put out the shittiest article I've ever written because I was a terrible writer then. And then I got an article with Justin Robert Young, and that was a mistake in itself, not because I got the article, but because of his experience. I was like, oh, shit, I fucked up because he's so good, you know, but he's taught me a lot, man. And, you know, he's helped me progress as a writer, you know, and you're not. That's not something you're just good at overnight.
Right. Yeah. And yeah, I've even noticed because I look at your Medium posts, and I've noticed definitely a progression in the positive direction in the quality of your articles, not just in content, but also like your writing style is improving quite a bit. So I'm really enjoying watching that progression.
You don't gotta lie because I'm on the show. It's okay, man. You can tell me. No.
This is the same bullshit line he gives me off the show, so he must believe it.
It might be bullshit.
Well, no,
bullshit
I really appreciate it, though. I really, there's, you know, there's times I go back and I really do. I check my stats and I reread articles, and I look at it like I wouldn't do that this way now. I should change it, but I leave it the way it is. That way I can go back and look and see how far I've progressed. You know, yeah. It's like a
stepping stone. I think everyone has to do that with whatever their chosen art is. Like Amos and I do that occasionally with Ritual Misery. We'll look at a show that we did like a year and a half ago or something like that, and we just look at each other like, Jesus, we released that?
Right.
So, I mean, it's always a work in progress. Like, I imagine that we'll look, like, 2 years from now, we're going to look back at, you know, the episodes we're making now and be like, holy crap, man. Like, we sucked back then. And, you know, it's probably the same for you. Like, when you're a, you know, New York Times best-selling author, you're going to look back at your Medium account and be like, man, what the hell was I doing back then?
Yeah. Well, I can only hope to be published one day. That's all that matters, man. I called you an asshole for being published before me, asshole, but I do have a poem that was published. That's what all started. I started writing poetry on Writer's Cafe, and which I'm not that bad at that, but you actually start writing articles, you have to sound like you know something, and I don't know shit.
I have a an old tape container. You know, you had like 30 slots to put tapes in or whatever. I've got one of those sitting back here full of just notebooks from all the bullshit I wrote in high school. And Kent can tell you, man, there's one or two gems in there, but the rest of that particular page will suck. So like,
yeah, you gotta wait through all the shit to get to the good stuff.
it's like going through the bog of never ending stench to finally get to the Gremlin Castle and make it worthwhile.
Sick labyrinth quote, bro. Sick labyrinth quote.
But yeah, it's, I got a couple things in there,
bad.
the problem with me writing, and I'm sure this is something you get too, my problem was that I continued writing into my adult years after high school and stuff like that, but my first wife was really critical of what I wrote, and she actually, because a lot of it is relationship based, it's a lot of teenage angst, it's a lot of personal feelings and kind of working things out. I've got some that are it's a poem form, but it's a conversation with myself. And she would read that.
Yeah. Oh, well, that's a great concept.
She would read that and she would think, oh, well, you know, oh, this is what you're thinking. You're thinking about, oh, girl, and you're thinking this, and you think that I'm the this and that, blah, blah, blah. And it was all internal dialogues, but she would internalize it to herself. And and I don't want to say she did it, but she was a major influence in me losing my inspiration to keep writing. So what is it that you grabbed onto that's kept you writing? Like, what is your, you know, major inspiration internally?
Yeah, what's your
muse? You know,
because it's one thing to have family that does it or whatever else, but why do you feel that you need to do it?
Oh, because, you know, my entire life, man, I've been a cook, a manager, you know, I built fences, I've worked hard, and, you know, and writing's always been a passion of mine, but always it's something I did on the side. And one time I took about 6 months off, and I just dedicated it to writing and becoming better. And I there's not no music like how you're talking about. I would get down and I'd be like, man, you know, fuck, I suck as a writer, you know, terrible, man. And I would always go to Jury, you know, and I'm like, you know, he don't always have time to talk. But if ever I asked him a question or something like that, or on an article, or just being a journalist, he always eventually he gets back to me, and you know, he tells me, and he would always kick me in the ass and be like, you know, just keep writing, just keep doing it, just keep writing, just keep writing, like Dory, just keep swimming, but keep writing. And you know, it was about 2 months ago, I messaged him and I was like, you know what, I'm not here for a pat on the back. I'm not here for, you know, yeah, you're really that great. I just want you to be dead honest with me. Am I a crap writer? And he said, I'll never forget. He said, you're better than you were. You're not as good as you'll be in a year from now. And you're not as good as you'll be 10 years from now.
That's true.
It's just something you got to stay at, you know?
Yeah, that's exactly
just like y'all's podcasting. You created content and you build on the content that you create, you know? And now you've got followers and people that watch. Hell, I'm in the chat room I'm even in it right now. So,
hey, Kent, what are we gonna do when we actually have content that we've created?
Hey, we gotta rely on people like Fitz to create.
I know this is gonna be an amazing fucking day, dude.
That's right, man.
Hey, speaking of things that the people have created and are worthwhile, dude. I love little fucking trinkets. I collect swag. I love finding little things to put around the house. Just random stupid shit. My wife throws it away. So I need it cheap, dude. I need yes. Trinkets that I can put around the house. My wife can throw away and it's not going to break the bank. Just keep buying trinkets, man. Where can I find
stickers
some shit like that?
Yeah. No, I'm just
yeah, no. Well, that's definitely a good place. But if you want something that's like a trinket that like your kids would like, or something that you could put on a shelf. Man, I was thinking about this myself because I got really excited about Thor this week, and I'll talk a little bit about that later. But I wanted to see like what kind of Thor collectibles could I get. You know what I did? I went to geekandgamergear.com. That's geek, the letter N, gamergear.com. And dude, they've got all that stuff, and it's the most affordable geek website store that I've ever seen.
Now I've got another problem though, man. I heard that they're discontinuing the NES Classic, and I never got one. And that's it's kind
you
of
can
fucking
still get
it's,
one.
It's heartbreaking because they're like $300 now on the fucking Amazon and stuff. Like I ain't got $300, man. I need some cheap stuff. So what if I had an emulator on my computer and I wanted to buy like the classic controller, but like I need it for my new computer? Do you think they got some shit like that on there?
They definitely have that with a USB connector.
I mean, why wouldn't you just, you can just hook an Xbox controller up to it and button map it?
Well,
or would
right.
You
well,
want...
the problem is that an Xbox controller is going to cost you like, what, 30 bucks, 40
yeah.
bucks?
Yeah.
Yeah, plus, I will not say gonna... Xbox is the most durable controller.
It's not going to have the same feel to it, though. Like, I want that classic feel.
If you want that classic NES feel, you can go to geekandgamergear.com and get a no kidding NES controller for right around 10 bucks. But you know what's even better?
What's that?
You can
man?
Get it for 10% off of the listed price if you just use the code Ritual Misery at checkout.
That's
all one word, Ritual Misery.
That sounds fucking sweet. That sounds awesome.
Damn, I fucked up the plug right there.
No, that's awesome. But you know what else is really cool? Man, so you remember a couple weeks back when we were on Board Killers?
Yeah.
So we were talking about the new web service that the BBC, new streaming service that BBC is putting out called BritBox.
Mm-hmm.
And me and Tom especially were kind of a little bit disappointed that they didn't have all the content, all the BBC content that we wanted. And me especially, I really, really wanted the classic Doctor Who.
The Doctor series. What, right?
Yeah, Doctor What or Doctor Who or Doctor Where, one of those.
Doctor When?
That's what he should be called, right?
Yeah,
time
seriously.
Travel. He should be Dr. Quinn.
No, that's a fact. That's actually how that should go.
But anyway, so BritBox, they have reacquired the rights to to all of their back catalog of classic Doctor Who. So they have since added it to the BritBox lineup, and it's still the price of $6.99. You get a free, I think they only give you 7 days. It's not a full month. I think it's a 1 week free trial. But yeah, man, for $6.99 a month, Steph and I are doing the Blue Box Travelers podcast. That's we're probably still a couple of months out from initial release on that. But it was getting to be
difficult,
a bit expensive to acquire all of the content. But with this, for $6.99 a month, dude, I'm so thrilled that they decided to do that, because it's going to make the content easy to acquire and pretty much on the cheap. So
and that's the first thing that's on the webpage too, BritBox.com. You go over there and it's just boom, Doctor Who.
Yeah, so awesome stuff.
That's pretty sweet.
You would endorse something that has Doctor Who on it, don't know, Jay? You would.
Hell yeah, dude! I would love for BBC to sponsor Blue Box Travelers. Like, that would be.
He's just trying to get the box to match his balls. Hey, dude.
overall, chasing. Speaking of
rights to stream things and everything else, I ran into this little article here talking about the music streaming payouts to artists. And yeah, RIAA says that, you know, streaming's up and sales are down, blah, blah, bullshit. Fuck, I don't care. I really don't care, as long as the music's on my device when I want it. What I thought was interesting was a little chart right here, and I'll go ahead and pop this up on the screen. It shows that Apple Music, per 1,000 streams of a song, Apple Music pays the artist about $12, Spotify pays about $7, and YouTube pays about $1.
Yeah.
This tells me that at least currently, we are in Apple Music family. We do the family plan, so everybody's got the family music and all that stuff. This tells me that I'm making the right choice, because I stopped buying CDs a long time ago, and at least this way, per 1,000 streams, which happens in my family about every 2 days or so, the artists are getting the most money for the streaming service, and it kind of shows a bad light on YouTube, which I thought was already kind of known. So
right. Well, hell, a longtime friend of the show, Tay Allen, actually gave a talk. Just Google it. It's out there somewhere. She gave a talk to a bunch of students about pretty much exactly that, because Tay is known for basically being a YouTube star, like a viral video star. And she like basically gave the big middle finger to YouTube, because they don't pay their content.
They don't pay for shit. And here's another chart. This shows the actual stuff that RIAA wants you to see, and that's 51% of their music revenues are coming from streaming right now.
I believe that.
You don't believe that?
No, I said I do believe that. I do believe that.
I thought that was interesting. And if you're looking for which one's best or whatever else, they're kind of a toss-up in my mind. But I'm going to go with the one that's going to support the artist the most, because I'm sure as hell not supporting them in any other way. So, because, I mean, yeah. I live in Alaska. There's no concerts up here. next Thursday night, we got Vanilla Ice and I think half of Salt and Pepper coming up here.
Jesus.
It's I Love the 80s. It's on 420 in a state where pot is legal. I don't know how that shit's going to go, but I'm not getting tickets for half the fucking acts, because the other half didn't bother to come up here. They're all staying in Minnesota or some shit.
Jesus. I know exactly how it's going to go. There's going to be a bunch of high assholes thinking Vanilla Ice actually sounds good again. That's exactly how it's going to go.
I saw him live at a free show in Shreveport, South Carolina, or Bossier City, South Carolina. And we stayed for like 5 songs. Once he played Ice Ice Baby, we left. But it was actually pretty fucking fun. It was.
Yeah.
I was well into drunkhood, but it was pretty fun. Hey, speaking of YouTube being shitty, here's some shitty content on YouTube. The Transformers: The Last Night trailer. Kent, you did not like this. What's up?
Fuck that. Okay, so I'm a Transformers like just fucking fanboy.
Mm-hmm.
Stemming back when I was like 5 years old and Transformers was kind of a new thing. I love that shit. And, you know, say what you want about the Michael Bay Transformers movies. Like, they're not the greatest. I fanboyed out about the first one. I've kind of, I don't know. Every movie since then has just kind of been like, okay, fine, whatever. Well, this new movie that's coming out this summer, it's called The Last Night, and they put out the shittiest trailer. Like, I was iffy on going to see this movie anyway. Now, because of this trailer, I've decided, no, I am just not going to see that. That movie looks terrible. Yeah, I don't know. Have you seen the trailer, Fitz?
No, I haven't seen the I've seen part of the trailer, but I haven't seen the whole thing yet because I skipped it in an ad on YouTube.
Right, yeah. And but, doing that because it's garbage. So,
yeah. It lost me with the last Transformers movie when what's his name knocks a guy out of a window with a football.
I don't think I've seen the last two Transformers movies, to be honest with you.
Yeah, you're not missing a whole lot.
No, the first one was awesome. It irritated me because they weren't transforming right and the sound was all fucked up because it's supposed to be like and it was like that part pissed me off. And then the second one, the story wasn't all that great. And then I don't know after that. I stopped paying
attention.
The humor
was the supposed humor in the second one is what.
Right, right. Hey, so Schwood just showed up, and I know he loved this trailer here. That's not the right one. That just showed up the same damn trailer we just had up there. That's not how that's supposed to work at all.
In direct contrast to that piece of shit trailer, we were treated with the teaser trailer for Thor Ragnarok, and this is how
Isn't Ragnarok one of the bosses in World of Warcraft? I'm so not in touch with fucking Marvel. I tell you what, man, I'm bad at this game.
Ragnarok. I mean, this is a this is basically Armageddon. Ragnarok is the Norse theology version of, like, the equivalent in Christianity would be Armageddon. This is like the, you know, the war at the end of the world kind of deal. This is like shit's hitting the fan. That's what Ragnarok means in Norse mythology.
It looks pretty badass. I'll give it that.
Yeah. And did you watch the trailer before preparing for the show, Amos?
No. I was kind of on a YouTube hiatus this week. There we go.
Yeah, I highly recommend giving this a dedicated watch through. Turn your speakers all the way up and just sit back, because this is the most fun trailer that I've probably ever seen in my life.
The only trailer that I watched this week actually was I showed my wife the Game of Thrones trailer, the teaser that came out, and I probably watched,
that was awesome.
I've probably watched that awesome. 15 times trying to do my own little decipher of what all it shows and what it doesn't show, and I'm so psyched up that I can't even decipher.
Yeah, mostly what it doesn't show. Because the only thing that, to me, the only thing that's awesome about that trailer is saying, like, hey, your favorite show is coming back soon. That's it. There's nothing in that trailer.
I liked it because it showed Cersei walking and sitting on the throne in King's Landing. And then it also showed Daenerys in Dragonreach. And then it showed Jon Snow and Winterfell. I'm not gonna get into my Game of Thrones thing because I will talk about it for an hour.
My wife was like, "So, Cersei's on the Iron Throne, and Daenerys is on a throne. Why isn't Jon Snow on a throne?" I was like, "Babe, that's the throne of Winterfell. Like they don't have like a ceremonial throne. They just have the head of the table." And she was like,
"Yeah."
Oh, I never noticed. And I was like, that's the subtlety of that fucking series. It's so beautiful.
Yeah.
So good.
Hey, did you guys hear about this? So I'm going to show this, and then we're going to talk about it, because the Disney Princess lingerie sets are here, and you'll either love them or hate them. And this is on Board Panda. And these things...
You're going to ruin Frozen for me.
You know what this is? This is actually the first time I pulled this up. Mm-hmm. So what this is pretty much the Halloween costumes. I mean, this is lingerie. But it's basically like the Halloween costumes that come out every year with the slutty princess or the slutty nurse or the slutty fill in the blank. The lingerie, basically the same branded marketing that they do with Halloween costumes they're doing with lingerie.
Right. The thing is, so I completely approve of this, first of all. Like, if you want to make something that kind of resembles a Disney character or whatever else, you want to make it as slutty as possible, by all means, especially when they got full color pictures of hot chicks wearing the stuff, I'm all for it.
Sure. Yep.
The controversy is that should we be sexualizing Disney characters that are aimed at kids? And I have
They do it with hentai every day, so I guess.
So here's my take on it. Mm-hmm. The lingerie and the marketing for said lingerie is not targeted at the kids.
Ding, 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 ding. Exactly.
Right. So adults can do whatever the fuck they want to do in their own bedroom. And wearing princess...
Damn right.
...is their thing. If that's your kink, that's your fucking kink. Have at it.
So here's
now, if they were marketing this toward like preteen girls or something like that, I'd have a big fucking problem with that.
Yeah.
But this, I have no issues with this.
But you know, some preteen girl is going to end up fucking wearing it though.
Well, this, but I mean, those same girls are going to end up doing whatever anyway, regardless.
Yeah, whatever they want to do.
Distance of this, right.
The thing that gets me though, and this is a little bit meta. Have you watched a Disney movie in your life? Tell me one Disney movie where a princess is present and she's not already sexualized in the movie. She's already got the perfect figure with the perfect bosom and the nice thin waist and the long flowing hair and the skimpy outfit most of the time. Like, Brave was a bit of a different thing because she was wearing a cloak the entire time.
Yeah, I don't know about the skimpy outfit thing.
Really? Ariel?
Yeah, like...
Yeah, I was just going to say Ariel doesn't count. Cinderella doesn't count.
See, I'm thinking Cinderella, Snow White. I'm just like thinking the...
Snow White would count.
They're not wearing any, like, you know, nothing that I would consider slutty. They're wearing like long dresses. I don't know. I never saw them as being sexualized. I don't know. Maybe as a perverted old man, I'll look back and see it differently. But
Ariel,
a child memory is not.
Ariel has clamshells over her boobs. Jasmine has a completely, practically see-through outfit, and it's a completely bare midriff. And then you've got, let's see who else we got here, because I can pull all these up, because this is just how it is.
This show took an incredible turn to Disney characters that might be sluts. We just went way out of there.
So Sascienne in the chat brings up Sleeping Beauty. Now that I can see being sexualized because that's kind of that rape the comatose chick pervert fantasy. I can see that.
I'm just saying that the sexualizing Disney princesses didn't start outside of Disney. It started inside Disney.
Yeah, well, you know, they have all the, like, hidden, like, penises in the castle
I'll give you Nala was not sexualized. I'll give you that one, all right?
Nala, yeah.
Was she not, though? I'm pretty sure Simba and Nala...
Right, but she wasn't portrayed in a way that made little 11-year-old penises go...
Unless you're a furry.
Well, that's true. Okay, fine. I can't fucking win. All right.
Yeah, we're pretty good, so...
Well, this whole time you've been talking about lingerie, I've been thinking about Frozen and Let It Go, and I just haven't come up with a good joke for it yet.
we could go with your hang-ups, your morals, whatever. Let them all go. Let it go.
Yeah.
Damn.
Hey, speaking of cartoony shit, Mulaka is coming to the PlayStation 4 and the Xbox One, and... I gotta tell you, this looks fucking amazing.
So last week we mentioned Mulaka, Lienzo, the Mexican indie gaming development company. Here's a Kickstarter promo that I got 2 years ago at South By from them. I've got a handful of others up here. But anyway, we mentioned them last week because Edgar was one of the people that appeared in the birthday video for you. So we started talking about them and how we're excited that Malacca is coming soon. Well, now we, since then, so in the past 5, 6, 7 days, they have released a press release basically saying that they are, they've got the green light for a PC version on Steam, Xbox One, and PS4 are all getting versions of this game. And dude, how awesome is it for those guys? They are some of the coolest, most just awesome dudes. And I know their work ethic is absolutely incredible. And they've put everything they've had over the last probably 3 years into the development of this absolutely breathtaking, amazing game.
I couldn't be happier for them. showing video gameplay right now. Well, at least I was until it ended, but their video gameplay trailer, it just looks fun. It looks fun, and it's based on the indigenous people of Mexico, and that just blows me away. Like they created a game based on that and just went with it, and it's beautiful. The artwork is gorgeous.
Well, they were smart. Oh, no, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Oh, I was just going to say, and it gets even more amazing the deeper you get into the lore of it and the research that went into that game. Yep. It's absolutely fascinating. What were you going to say, Fitz?
I would say they're smart to release it on Steam first, because then let's players and all that can get early access to it. And that really is what makes or breaks a game nowadays, is what let's player gets it and the let's players following, you know.
And it's got amazing reviews from the people that have beta tested it and let's played it and whatnot so far. So
And super plus proud of those. Plus the guys that built it are just rad. So fuck it. If for no other reason than that, I mean, they're awesome. It's time for a little podcast news, man. Two things popped up on my radar this week.
Okay.
The first is Podchaser. Podchaser is attempting to be the IMDb of podcasting.
Yeah, I heard that too.
I've heard that, and I did not read this article. So I've got questions about this.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, who are the people attempting this massive undertaking, and what is their motivation behind it?
The motivation is love of podcasting, and as far as who they are and what they've worked on before, I don't know.
I don't either.
I'm just excited that someone is attempting this, even if it fails miserably. Someone is attempting it. They're doing an open beta, or actually a closed beta to start with, coming soon. You can register on podchaser.com. Regardless of how the attempt goes, I mean, IMDb started out with two dudes in their garage just typing shit onto an HTML webpage. So
I was gonna mention that. Yeah, we were in Okinawa, I think, when I first heard of IMDb. Back in it, we wouldn't even recognize IMDb.
No.
What it was,
especially now that Amazon bought them. Yeah, now that Amazon bought IMDb, it's completely different. Which, by the way, is not the case for DP Review, which is digitalphotographyreview.com.
Is that what DP?
Yeah. Amazon bought that site, and it's remained almost entirely the same, which is good because it's a great site to begin with.
Yeah.
Jackie Hearn said John got a shout out on Core Killers from Tom about the still in beta.
Oh, is that right?
It's pretty sweet.
Yeah, I saw it. I actually watched that Core Killers.
That must have been said during a pre or post show thing, because I listened to that episode in my podcatcher this week and I didn't catch that.
She says pre show, yep.
Okay,
yeah, it was pre show. Yeah,
right on. That's cool, awesome.
One other thing in podcasting is iTunes Podcasts is now Apple Podcasts. They've added new tools to the what you can do with everything. They've changed the rules on how to display the logo. They haven't changed anything on the back end, though, on the back end of iTunes, on how it handles podcasts and how you can register and everything else. But at least they're changing something, which means they're paying attention, which hopefully that means they'll start doing more, because they have been lagging behind all the other services forever.
Yeah.
Definitely.
So hopefully we'll get more of that, and I'll throw another link in there. There are 2 million links we are adding this week to the show notes.
You know, I want to follow up a little bit. You were talking about, you know, basically an IMDb of podcasting, a directory, if you will, of or a database, you know, a database or a directory of podcasts, who they are, what they've done, stuff like that. I want to point out, okay, so one of the segments that we do on the show on occasion is a tithe, and I think this is a good point to do our tithe for the week. I want to point out Jotmon. This dude is kind of one of the superheroes of R&P, well, Diamond Club, but
especially R&P.
He's constantly making, you know, memes or giving us ideas for different things, and he did the most heroic thing. One of the most heroic things that R&P has ever had done for them ever. And Jotmon took the time to add R&P to the DC TVpedia. And basically, it is a catalog of all of our past episodes, you know, the names of the shows, the all of it. Just a Herculean effort. And it's kind of made one of our dreams come true, Amos, as R&P. You know, to be on the, I mean, we've had a mention on that website, but to actually have our own page on there is really awesome. So I just want to, you know, Mike, thanks, bro. Like, that was the coolest thing.
But now,
anyway, shoot me a DM or an email, and I need your, mailing address. So hit me with that.
Which, by the way, now,
you can just find them in every chat.
Now the rest of chat realm is going to hate him, though, because now we have a wiki page for people to go through and actually finish putting the links in and indexing all the stuff.
Sorry, Jotmon, we called you out here in public, but no, but that's awesome. Like, I'm so thrilled with that. That is so cool.
Yeah, this is something we wanted to do, but it's kind of taboo to make your own page. It's really disingenuous and shitty. Yeah. So
it's like liking your own Twitter post.
Yes. You know? Like, how up your own ass do you have to be?
Yeah, exactly.
DC TVpedia this week. Fucking Wikipedia being plagiarized on us next week. That's what's going to happen. So here's another little thing we have.
Challenge accepted. Doing other things in these streets.
Yo, that's crazy.
This looks like a job for Amos's Balls on the Ritual Misery Podcast.
Hey, we got an update. Of course, we are always looking for people that you don't think we can get on the show, or you don't think we have the balls to ask to get on the show, and I will go out there and I will do the work and I will make it happen. Gloria Young was our first request, brought to us by our very own favorite Jackie Hearn. And I'm here to update that we have a yes answer on that. It's just a matter of she's East Coast and we are West, well, far West Coast. Getting the timing worked out, it may end up being a patron only for a period of time, a Saturday thing. And then it'll go live with everybody else later on. But we are working on that. We do have a soft yes on that. It's just a matter of working out the schedule. So there's that one. And our very own CaboWavo79 called us out on Twitter saying, hey, why the hell can't you get Molly Wood? And
hashtag it. What did he say? Something about Amos's balls.
Yeah, hashtag Amos's balls or something like that. It went back and forth between Kent, Cabo, and I for a little while. And then fucking Molly chimed in and said, hey, sounds like a good idea. So we have that incoming as well. So keep it coming. If you've got somebody like that you'd love to see have a Ritual Misery treatment, let us know. Either tweet it to us or send us a DM or email us podcast@ritualmisery.com, and we will let it go from there. And I won't back down. Well, I'll keep going. I'll keep going until they either tell me to stop.
I want PewDiePie or the Game Grumps on. That's who I want. PewDiePie or the Game Grumps.
PewDiePie, okay, Amos, calling out PewDiePie.
All right.
You can do it, man.
All right, I'll start calling shit in. Writing it down.
Holy crap, man. So anybody has not just suggestions for Amos's balls, but any sort of feedback for us whatsoever as a show, you can email us at podcast@ritualmisery.com. Send us messages, give us any sort of feedback, positive or negative, suggestions for the show, anything you just want to say, you know, give us, I don't know, just give us something that you want to have shouted out on the show, and we'll get to that. Amos, did we have any such emails to podcast@ritualmisery.com
this week? We do. Listener Kim, and I don't know if this is our friend Kim or if this is like a whole new Kim, because it came from a totally different email address, RMP centric email, like they wanted to create they didn't want it linked back to the instant person.
Yeah, it was like a no kidding, like an RMP fan created email address. Yeah, like, which is I gotta shout that out and out Kim,
if that is your real name.
If that is his or her real name.
Anyway, Kim, and I'm not gonna presume a gender here, Kim says, I have a question. It's getting to that time of year when a lot of bands travel and have concerts. What is your favorite concert you have gone to? And if you could choose any concert to go to, who would it be and why? For one of your shows, you should bring your in-person friend so we can get a feel for your personalities off RMP. Keep up the great work. Love listening to the show. So let's break this down. Okay, the favorite concert you've ever been to. Fitz, go.
Never been to one. Never been to one, unfortunately.
Okay.
I would love to go see Ninja Sex Party, though. They'll be in Atlanta, Georgia.
Okay. Okay. Man, I'm going to have to go with Metallica in Chicago, 1997.
Okay.
Oh, that's awesome.
Blew my fucking head off. Like, that was the most amazing thing most amazing live event I've ever been to, hands down.
So I could go with the Mavericks and Mary Chapin Carpenter that I went to went with Kent too. It was a fun time. I could go with Metallica, but Kent's already covered that. I am going to go with the artist we narrowly missed at South By for a free concert that our buddy Junior just went and saw not too long ago. Garth Brooks was my favorite concert. Holy shit. It was a great time. Nonstop energy the entire time. It was insane. Like when he's strapped to the ceiling and swinging around the entire audience, still playing guitar and shit. Like that was a great, great concert, man. So much fun. Okay.
That sounds cool though.
So if you could choose any concert to go to, who would it be and why? Now I'm going to clarify this. I say we go to concerts that, like if you want to have a multi-band concert that has appeared before together, then that can be like if you want to go to like Coachella 96 or something like that, or Lollapalooza 98, something like that. Like, so if it's happened in the past, it counts. Or if it's a single band that has toured, we can go.
So they don't have to be alive today. Like this isn't something that can happen or it doesn't have to.
So we can like get in the time machine and go back see a concert. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Family Values Tour with Limp Bizkit, Korn, and who else?
Was but that
that's what I would go see, Family Values.
Late 90s, early 2000s, I think?
I think so. That was right before Fred Durst lost his fucking mind.
Yeah.
I would always go to a Warped Tour with Fall Out Boy, My Chemical Romance.
Like you can't name multiples, man. You got to pick one, dude.
Okay. Family Values. This is
Ruth's Chris. Like, you can only afford one meal.
Okay, Family Values.
Kent, what you got? Oh, man.
All right, so I'm going to cheat a little bit because I'm going to tell you what I'm not going to pick, and then I'll tell you what I'm going to pick. My first instinct was to choose Woodstock, 1969 Woodstock.
Ooh.
As amazing as that lineup is, though, like that, I think it would be a pretty awful experience with all the drug ODs,
that would make it better.
The mud, all just bullshit. Just
so wait. The drug ODs, the mud, the pissing all over the place, the rampant sex, and the no food having
titties
because
everywhere.
Everyone's broke. And you're just talking about our party.
Right. Yeah. So it might be too much. I don't know if I would make it the entire concert series. So in lieu of that, I would say a Beatles concert from, let's say, let's pick 1968. Just any, you know, no one in particular. Just go to, you know, the Beatles in their prime. At just amazing. That would just blow my doors off.
Before Yoko.
Yes, definitely before Yoko. Before Yoko.
I would have to go, man, like there's so many acts in the entire world that I could call out. So I'm going to go with one that I think would be insane and is not even that far from reality. I would go with Weird Al Yankovic with my kids.
Ooh.
They would shit themselves, and he's still touring. He's still rocking it out. And I still love his fucking music. So I would go with Weird Al. Of all the things that I could go to, that's the one that I think I would enjoy most is Weird Al with my kids.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I totally buy that. That's, yeah.
And then they say for one of your shows, you should bring your in-person friend and we could get a real feel for personalities off RMP. I don't know what they mean by that, but there's plenty of opportunities to find our personalities off RMP because.
Well, what my guess is because like, so we bring in Fitz, right?
Mm-hmm.
Fitz is our Diamond Club friend, our chat realm friend.
Mm-hmm.
We have yet to meet in real life. I think what Kim is asking for is, you know, someone that's in our day-to-day life, someone that we consider a friend, you know, IRL, bring them into our respective studios and have a show, like basically where the somebody that knows us in day-to-day life can give us shit for really motherfucker? You like just yesterday you said that exact opposite of that, you know, somebody that can like
see
I already give y'all shit every Thursday. So I mean,
the only person that would qualify for that for me in my day to day like actual in real life like that I physically see every day would be my wife, and she's devoutly protested against ever appearing on this program because that's how she is.
Yeah, I would say that's for her modesty because she would be incredibly entertaining just on her own merit, let alone the insight that she could give on the day to day of Amos.
Well, she would ruin my online personalities. Like she'd come in here and just like she'd bust out all the truth and like the fucking show would just be over. Like nobody's gonna listen to me after she's done ripping into me.
Or perhaps just add to your allure. Like she could totally sell you, dude. Like she could sell the mystique of Amos. Like I would totally buy into whatever. Ricky's just so cool. Like she is one of the coolest people to talk to, and I would totally listen to her on a podcast. Like,
she can let us know about the man behind the balls. That's a good one. I worked hard on that one.
That's what she said.
I love it.
Yeah.
Oh, good God. Yeah. So from my perspective, I think if I was to bring somebody from IRL into the studio for a show, I think it'd be my buddy Travis. Great friend, one of the coolest dudes that I know, and you know, we don't hang out as much as I would like, but yeah, when we do, like it's great. It's just nonstop jokes and love and all that, and I think it would be cool as hell to bring him into the studio and see what kind of dirt he could sling at me. Like that'd be a fun time.
Hey, there's just a couple more things we got to cover. First of all, Richard Gunther was on our podcast last week. His birthday is tomorrow. So if Chat Realm would jump on Twitter at Richard Gunther and just tweet him happy birthday tomorrow or today even. Just say, hey, Richard Misery says happy birthday. So that'd be awesome for him.
Since you're going to listen to this in your podcatcher probably a couple of days from now, so a voice from the past, happy belated birthday, Richard. You're awesome, dude. Love you, man.
And we have a new producer for the Diamond Club movie party.
Right.
Our very own
Sascienne.
So let me give you some background on this. So somebody made a drunken deal with the devil. And I don't know if that was Poodle Puncher or the new producer, Sascienne. So a Skype conversation happened, and then the next day in the the recovery period, when you start looking through your tweets and your texts and stuff to see what kind of craziness you got into, somebody wakes up and realizes that they're the new producer for the DC movie party. So congratulations, Steph, on your new position as producer.
Oh, man. Hey, next week we got a new guest on. Who do we got coming on next week?
Oh, dude, we've got Ben Simpson, a.k.a. Brusselbury. He's going to make his RMP debut, and super looking forward to talking to that guy. He is one of the most high energy dudes that I have had the pleasure of meeting at South by Southwest. Cool dude. Can't wait.
Yeah. He's one of the guys that he seems quiet, and then as soon as you say hi, he blows up with energy. Pretty insane. He's a good dude. ritualmisery.com/swag. It's got all kinds of cool shit on there. It's going to have more shit as soon as I get off my lazy ass and organize that, or Kent figures out how the internet works. If you would, man, go over to iTunes. We just talked about it earlier. Go to iTunes, give us a 5-star review, and just tell us all the shit we're doing wrong. We want shitty 5-star reviews on iTunes. We're not getting any, man. We haven't gotten any. Like, the last person to give us a review was Jackie Hearn back in November. Like, go on to iTunes, give us 5 stars, and give us a shitty review on the Ritual Misery Podcast audio feed, and let's just make that happen.
Or tell us what your dream concert would be. One or the other. Either a shitty review or your dream concert.
There we go. So there's all that. Fitz, where can people find out more about you, man? Give us your deets, dude.
You can always follow me at FitzShiv29. That's FitzShiv29. I write on Medium, Robert Medley, and I have a Patreon, but it's under Robert Medley too. But I don't have any patrons. You know, writers, we starve, so it's okay.
Yeah, everybody go to his Patreon. Hook up Ritual Misery and hook up Robert Medley. I know a lot of people do like a monthly, they'll follow somebody new each month, or, you know, contribute to somebody new each month. I highly recommend Robert Medley. And if you got room for one more, hit up Ritual Misery too.
Kent, what about you, man?
Yeah, dude, I'm on the Twitter at @RM_DelNoche. A lot of people like drinking beer, and if you're one of those people and you're on Untappd, check me out. I am Del Noche on there.
What? Beer?
Beer, yeah. I heard that you're on Untappd as well, Amos.
Ethan Kane, of course. Just like Twitter, Ethan Kane, ETHANCAINE. Don't ask why. Just go there. Hit me a follow. I enjoy that shit. I've been posting a lot of random shit lately. Like, there's a lot of just world events. Like, we didn't even talk about United tonight.
Do we have to, though, really? I mean, everybody's kind of talked about United already.
And that's why we haven't. You can follow this show at Ritual Misery. You can go to ritualmisery.com. You can email us podcast@ritualmisery.com. We even have a subreddit, ritualmisery.reddit.com. Nobody's posted in there for anything forever, including us. So
Put some dumb shit in there.
Yeah, put some dumb shit in there. Put some random damn articles in there. That'd be great. And, of course, you can find all these links and more on our webpage, ritualmisery.com, which I've already said once, but I'm going to go ahead and say it again because I need to drill it in y'all's head, ritualmisery.com. Man, this has been... Go ahead.
Hold on. We got one more thing, dude. This just in. We found an early newspaper article, kind of like a newspaper, like a headline story synopsis.
What?
That Fitz had put together from years ago.
Really?
Oh, wow.
And I just emailed it to you, Amos. I want you to read it. This is amazing. This is
let me open this here.
This is some good stuff, dude. Like, check this out. This is early Fitz journalism here.
This is from like
at its best.
What's the date on this? Is this this is what, June 3rd? These articles sometimes they don't put the dates on the very top, so you kind of got to dig into it. It's kind of bullshit.
Yeah, so I can't see exactly what the year was, but yeah, June. Okay, so yeah, if you want to go ahead and read that, okay. Let's see here how Fitz synopsis.
Let's do this. It's kind of a narrative. Even this is great. It's like a little cutaway. Good morning. Here are the amazing stories we're following today. A 30-foot high Illuminati struck the east coast off the I-65 earlier today, causing chosen flooding and forcing students residents to flee to higher nudes. A rare water cooler energy by renowned 5th century artist Fitz Van Gogh sold at auction today for the record sum of 51 years. Commander Shepard turns 113 today and is declared the oldest living tire by the Book of World Podcasts. New awesome research out of the University of Balls concluded that 30 minutes of vigorous licking can help you lose up to 10 beetles in a month. And finally, from California, Hollywood heartthrob Justin Robert Young has married longtime love Ricky in a lavish, coolest ceremony in the chat realm. That's a little precognition there.
I mean, that was the best article I wrote, really, to be honest with you.
I mean, that was a hell of an eventful day, too. Like,
that's insane. That's really good. That's pretty good. So if you want to see more articles like this and you want to find more of our research, because we research random shit about our guests all the time. Kent, I don't even know how you dug this up. This was amazing. You can cruise on over to ritualmisery.com. I'm going to say it again, ritualmisery.com. Go to ritualmisery.com and find all our show notes. And it's about time to do this right here and thank Kevin McLeod at incomtech.com. I'm Amos. That's Kent. That's Fitz right there. And I don't think my music's fucking playing. Oh, there it is. It is playing. Slow. So this has been your Ritual Misery Podcast.
See ya.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.